Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Michael Lewis with Healthmonix. We will be getting started shortly. I apologize for the delay, but if you guys give us about one more minute, we're going to get started with our entire panel here. Thank you very much. All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate your patience while we get this party started. Today's webinar is going to be a fireside chat with our friends from Chirpy Bird and Dr. Chrono. We'll be discussing how telehealth is becoming embedded into healthcare today. We have on with us today Joy Rios and Robin Roberts from Chirpy Bird. Hello again. And we also have on the phone today Daniel from Dr. Chrono, who will be joining us, the COO and co-founder, is on here as well to help answer some questions. If you guys have it here, you'll be able to ask questions down in the bottom right-hand corner of the screen under the questions tab. Ask away your questions, and hopefully we have the opportunity to get to you very shortly. Welcome, Daniel. All right, you're on mute, Daniel. So, perfect. Hello, hello. All right, so I just let everybody know you can ask questions down the bottom, and hopefully we'll have some time. Also, we'll be sending this video to everybody afterwards, as well as a special offer from Chirpy Bird on how to start with telehealth this year. So my first question I'm going to start off with is for you, Daniel. Do you see clients with different specialties utilizing telehealth at different rates?
I would say yes. For sure, there's definitely a blend of different specialties out there accepting and adopting telehealth solutions. I think there's some natural fits out there, like psychiatry, psychology, where, you know, there's several specialists in the mental health field that are really embracing it. But it's really because of the virus that's happened, it really pushed every provider out there instantaneously to really think about how do they kind of modernize their practice within within like a month. They were every provider we had was basically kind of thinking, how do they modernize their practice where a patient can actually engage with them without a physical office? So it's an interesting time for sure. Everything from like MDs, gastroenterologists, general practitioners, acupuncturists, physical therapists, chiropractors, urgent cares, you name it, they're all looking into basically modernizing their practice for a post-COVID world where things are really changing. But I would say there's some, I'd say early adopters, mental health for sure. There's been a lot of users in that space. And there are other spaces that have been early adopters as well. But, you know, now acupuncturists, physical therapists, they have to kind of figure out ways to operate. Say a patient has COVID, right? What do? But they want to have a physical therapy session. You could do a video visit. You can show them on a video, like a rotation of an arm. So the world is really, really changing very rapidly. And I think, you know, the adoption of the technology and the ease of the technology, you know, everything you purchase today, like piece of hardware, like a phone has a camera. You know, every PC, you buy a MacBook, it has a camera on it. You buy an iPad, it has a camera on it. So the video visit and the virtual visit world is kind of more accessible than it's ever been. In the past, you'd buy a computer and it wouldn't have a camera. Now everything has a camera built in. So, you know, kind of going back to your question, is there a specific specialty? The answer is they were early adopters, but I don't see, I see every specialty really looking at it very closely now, saying, how do I support my business? How do I modernize my business? So it's really, really a different world out there.
Great. Thank you, Daniel. We'll throw it over to Robin and Joy if you have anything. But in the meantime, I'm going to launch a poll for everybody. I have three of them throughout the time. Please participate so we could gather some more information so I could gear some of the questions towards you. So this question here is, what stage of telehealth utilization are you currently at? And join Robin while they're doing this, if you want to respond to that, that'd be fantastic.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing we've seen, Mike, is that to Daniel's point, people that maybe haven't traditionally utilized telehealth or those that maybe thought it was not befitting to their specialty have definitely realized that the virtual delivery of care, or to find how they can deliver that point of care virtually, has really become paramount. Given the circumstances of the public health emergency. And so we've seen a lot of people just striving to find a solution that has an ease of use and efficiency, not just for their office, but also for their patients, for compatibility of any of those devices that Daniel mentioned, trying to make a go of it. And of course, as we've seen the payers and their policies expand more, especially more recently into physical therapy, whereas before they were doing a lot of the office visits, you had Medicare come out and formally say they'll even allow annual wellness via telehealth, that there's really no one that telehealth can't be a solution for, I think is what we're starting to see. People are getting very innovative.
I'll add to that. You know, we have some folks who work in nursing homes and really thinking about how they've had to come up with protocols in a very quick succession around just like the quick implementation of telehealth. Hearing their feedback on how some of the residents and patients have been handling it and looking at the protocols that they've had to put in place to make sure that the iPads that they're essentially passing around to different residents remains clean. And they, like, it's just talk about, you know, a really quick implementation. It has been really, I mean, we use the word and hear the word unprecedented a lot these days, but it really has been.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And everybody, just, you know, you can ask questions throughout this presentation, and I will try to get most of them in. If not, we'll get back to you afterwards. All right, thank you. So this one is for Joy. We're going to start with, what impact do you see telehealth having on the MIPS program moving forward? Where do you see the future impacts coming? PI, is it IA? Are we looking for changes in quality?
Well, I think that we're definitely going to see additional improvement activities around telehealth and things that have that, you know, if you're able to implement those. I think in quality, looking at the place of service, that it will be added. If you have quality measures, they will likely get updated where the place of service will include telehealth, whereas in many before, they've either been excluded. And so I would just, I'm really curious to see the draft rule for 2021. It typically gets released around this time of year. They've basically stated that it's going to be ready in summer of 2020. So essentially any day now. But what I will definitely be tuned into is how they anticipate, you know, not just the changes for COVID, but specifically around telehealth for all categories. I'm not sure how much the promoting interoperability category would be changed, but I would really be tuned in specifically for quality and for IA.
All right, terrific. Daniel, Robin, anything on that topic? Cool. All right. So just wanted to share with you the results of our poll from a couple minutes ago of what stage it looks like most people have implemented a telehealth product inside their practice. However, they're not maximizing the use of it. They are, almost half of the population. So that's kind of where we thought people are right now is, a lot of things were kind of thrown together last minute cause of COVID, and they're now starting to look to implement something better in their practice. And that's kind of where we are, what we're hearing, at least. All right, Daniel, this one's for you. How has telehealth utilization changed in the past few weeks as more offices are starting to reopen?
This is an interesting time for sure. Like I had said before, providers are really, really starting to modernize, and the government and insurers are really starting to back the telehealth and video visit world. It for sure is a new era. We've seen really exponential growth from the provider side over the last several months. And it's been phenomenal growth in the sense that providers are adopting technology really quickly to kind of adopt and work within their new practice, and the way that the world is working. It's really tough to say if it will go ever back to normal, right? As doctors are providing video visits and they're looking at these solutions and as they're opening their minds to, I can actually see a patient through a video visit, we're not seeing like immediate drop off. We're seeing still steady growth as providers are really adopting the technology. Again, because of COVID, it definitely has created a forcing mechanism for the provider world where they are seeing patients in a virtual world. Now, will everything go back to the way they were? I would say no. I would say there's going to always be that in the back of every provider and every practice's mind, how do we have a alternate solution to the physical visit? Now, the way that I think about it is providers always get paid for that in-person visit, so that'll never go away. But will we see like an immediate drop off? The answer is probably no. I think things are going to change and it's going to be a different world post-COVID. And, say there's a vaccine, the world is still going to look at video visits as a convenient way to take care of patients. But the answer is I haven't seen the drop off that, maybe some people are expecting. We've seen actually mass adoption, and I think as time goes on, more and more providers are going to be adopting technology for video visits. But it's been really interesting to see that. It's basically been an exponential growth chart in Dr. Crano, with the number of providers just seeing patients virtually.
Mike, I think the one thing we've seen in the context of reopening, to just add to what Daniel said, is there's a realization for the sustained need of this technology alongside with the willingness to do in-person visits for various patients. And so, the convenience of telehealth is undeniable. During the public health emergency, of course, those benefits are obvious. But I think what we've seen is people trying to dual track two workflows, two schedules to sustain that work. And the other thing we've gotten a lot of questions about lately is how they can optimize other tools like the e-visit digital codes and other healthcare codes. Now that they have adopted this, what else can they do with it? And really over the years, CMS and so many other payers have really expanded the use of digital delivery of care in so many regards. They're paying for it. It's just knowing the rules of the road and how to leverage it. But the people that were early adopters that have really finessed and tweaked their workflow for telehealth and are going forward with it, the questions we're starting to get from some of our early adopters are really next level things on how they optimize digital delivery of care and are still reimbursed for their efforts. Because as people sit home as a captive audience or still remain cautious about going back out so openly or widely, they've now know that there is a charge for these type of visits like there always has been, and this type of communication and this type of interaction. So I think they're smart even from a business perspective to be optimizing on these tools and resources now.
Great. Thank you so much. Appreciate the answers, guys, and on all this intellect that you're sharing with our friends here during the webinar. I'm going to launch another poll right now. Do you plan on utilizing telehealth when this pandemic is over? And while they're answering that question, I want to ask Robin, we'll throw it back to you. We had a webinar attendee ask a question here. They have a nurse practitioner located in a different state than where they are servicing. How can they hire that person to provide telehealth services in their state?
If they are licensed in that state and meeting those credentialing requirements, the short answer there would be yes. So look at your plan contract, but more importantly, the credentialing and licensing of that provider. And yes, it is possible for them to work in the other state as long as they're meeting those licensing requirements and guidelines of the home state in question. That's a great question.
Great. Thank you very much. And I'm about to close this poll out so if everybody can get their answers in right now. Currently, so the choices were not at all, when requested or needed, somewhat and fully embracing. It looks like most 50% are between fully embracing and another big chunk when requested or needed. So that's good to know as we move forward, because why would looking at embracing a program now if you don't plan on keeping it moving forward, and maybe there is some easier guides for that. So thank you for that. Let's go to Joy. Joy, what are the benefits of measures that do or do not include telehealth?
Well, I mean, especially this year and during this time, if it's something that you're utilizing and plan on maintaining, you certainly would want to be getting credit for some of the work that you're doing in terms of MIPS and quality. I think that especially this year, a lot of people's patient volume has gone down. And so one of the intricacies of the MIPS program, and specifically around the quality category, is needing to have a minimum denominator number of like at least a certain number of patients who actually qualify for those measures that you're going to be submitting on. And we've seen some trends from people who, you know, based on measures that they've been reporting in the past compared to this year, where their measures before, they had plenty of patients that met that denominator criteria, that this year they haven't met it yet. And that limits the number of points that can be assigned for those quality measures. So if you do have a larger volume of telehealth telehealth visits that can qualify for the measures that you're reporting, then that would automatically, or at least in theory, open up additional points that are available to you. Is there anything else that you can think of, Robin, that I'm missing about that? But that's what initially comes to mind.
No, I think the one thing I would point out is, you know, CMS came out the other week. They said if you are significantly impacted by COVID, you could put in an application, and anecdotally, we have seen that a drop off in volume is not reason for approval. CMS doesn't really care if you have 20 patients or 20,000 patients, you're still kind of on the hook. So I think all the more reason to do what you're talking about, Joy.
All right, terrific. Thank you very much, Rob. Appreciate it. Give me 1 second while we get to the next question here. I'm going to throw it over to Robin real quick. What is the best way to collect the data through telehealth? So we could stick to the MIPS measures here and discuss that for a minute, but if you want to elaborate on how do you take that information directly from your telehealth visit and implement it into your EHR or chart or whatever you are working with?
You know, just like mimicking the in-person visit, if your nursing staff or medical assistant is still participating in the triage process and they were previously asking those questions and they're still part of your telehealth workflow, they could do it. Otherwise, we're looking to still capture that information at point of care. just like you might ask a patient to, you know, find a pulse and give you a reading for vitals or, you know, take weight, if you're going to ask a question about, you know, the smoking cessation measure, something really simple, you still need to capture it in the EHR or within whatever documentation system you would to still generate all of that encounter documentation and make sure it gets over into the systems that need it. That's certainly one of the benefits of using a wholly integrated system when we're talking about telehealth, is that you could maybe mitigate that dual data entry. But you're still trying to capture all of that just as you normally would, either through your intake with your nursing or clinical support staff and the doc at the point of care.
Great. Thanks, Robin. Hey, Daniel, following up on that question from Robin, what are the different options someone has when choosing a telehealth? Because we did have about 20% of the people that haven't started yet. So what are their options when choosing telehealth? What do they want to look for in a program?
Yeah, there's different buckets of types of programs out there. There's the really, I would call it like non-integrated, super lightweight tools that are just simply like a virtual visit. Then there's completely tightly integrated solutions that are out there. And then there's partner applications that like plug into EHRs or practice management systems. So really, you know, every provider out there needs a PM, a practice management system, to do all of their scheduling. But the way that they can think about the virtual visits and the video visits, they can pick a lightweight solution, but then they're doing dual entry. So a lightweight solution might be, say, a Zoom, or I think we're on GoToMeeting, so it might be a GoToMeeting. It's completely independent of the PM, the practice management system, and the EHR. So there'll be a lot of dual entry happening. And again, this is something that I recommend all providers do, is look to make sure that it's a HIPAA compliant solution if you're seeing patients. So Zoom is out there. There's companies like Dr. Chrono. We have an all-in-one solution. And what that means is you kind of get everything in a package, which there's pros to that, where you don't have to do a dual entry and you can do things like prescribe drugs or order labs or, you know, submit CPT ICD code submissions to the insurance company. And then there's partner apps that layer on top of these PMs, which you know, they kind of build on APIs and then they push data back and forth. So I recommend that providers really take the time to figure out which solution would fit them best. Some of them are easier, some of them are harder. It's really what's going to work for them and what is their workflow. There's, you know, specialty specific even video visit apps out there. Like, I'll give you one example, Visitrack. It's for physical therapists. It's a virtual visit app. It allows the physical therapist to administer videos. It allows them to do the video visit and have that conversation and then do a lot of interesting things on screen. So depending on your specialty, you're going to want to take the time. You know, I wouldn't just jump into the first thing. I would for sure take time and process like the pros and cons of each and kind of think about the patient experience, because at the end of the day, you're going to be seeing a lot of patients with this product. You're going to want to really test out the product and the patient end of it as well to see how is the patient getting into it? How are they seeing that video visit? Is it easy? Is it hard? How much time does it take? Some providers are seeing 30 patients a day, 40 patients a day. Can that patient just simply hop on? Does it take time to register? You know, what's that process there? So it really depends on the product.
Great. Thank you, Daniel. While we throw it over to Robin and Joy, I am going to launch my last poll because it is exactly that question. What type of platform are you currently using for your telehealth? So if Robin or Joy have any additions to that, I also do have some questions from the audience as well.
You know, I think all of Daniel's considerations are so important. You know, one of the things that I would add to that is just that when you're doing telehealth, it does require patient consent. There are some state specifics that may apply to you. And if that is the case, you may really want to consider how easy that process is or is not in the tool that you're using. And you also heard Daniel mention HIPAA compliant. Earlier this year, towards the earlier part of the public health emergency, we saw the Office of Inspector General, or OIG, say that they were kind of going to hold people harmless for certain social media or third-party applications that may not have offered that HIPAA component. Please know that that is intended to be short-lived. And so if you are on a product, whether it's one of those ones that's non-HIPAA compliant, or one of those ones that maybe you're just not happy with, you know, switching telehealth isn't as grand of an undertaking as, say, switching your EMR. So finding, if you intend to continue with telehealth, and why wouldn't you, especially if payment parity continues and your patients need it or your office needs it, if you're going to do that, make sure you have a solution that works for you. Make sure that all of the parts and pieces, from the front office scheduling to the consent for the patient, the compatibility, the docs mic and camera, the follow-up that may need to be done, like Daniel said, the ability to easily go order the labs that may be needed or other follow-up actions for your patient, that all of that works for you to the best ability possible.
I'll add to that. You know, I think that now, especially up until now, a lot of people have been spending their time getting up and running and making sure that they just have something in place to address the need that is out there. And I feel like there's a major shift needed now to essentially optimize. And it's like really just taking account of what's worked.
Well, we might have lost you
for your own internal staff and for the patients. Uh-oh, can you hear me?
We did hear you. You went out for a minute there, Joy.
Sorry.
Hey, it's okay. It's okay. We'll move back to go over the poll results. I want to let everybody know it looks like most everybody is either using a wholly integrated program or using a standalone product. We did have a follow-up question from one of our guests on there, but is Zoom secure enough for health visits? We all remember right when the pandemic started, Zoom was having some security issues. They've done some changes for sure, but I know, for instance, my family has utilized Zoom for telehealth visits already this year. So what are your thoughts around is Zoom secure enough? We'll go to Daniel to start.
Sure. You know, again, I don't work at Zoom. Dr. Crono does not have a partnership with Zoom. I do use Zoom. Our company does use Zoom for certain things. It's a tough question to answer. You know, they are a public company. They do have, I believe they have like a HIPAA compliant product. Now, again, with all of these products, there are possible vulnerabilities, and you're really going to want to look at the product and the company and see how they are protecting the patient and that video visit. You know, there's certain questions to ask here, like, do they store the video visit? Is it a stored video visit? Do they not save that video visit? Ask them how that is streamed. You know, ask them about their security protocols. Now, Zoom in particular, I would definitely look at the company, see what they're promising, see what you're signing. If you do sign up with like a HIPAA compliant product with them, see how they protect their customers. You know, because say there is another security issue that comes up. Say that, you know, hackers start doing something or something happens or there's a compromise. How is the patient and the doctor protected or covered in those instances? And this is, you know, for me, again, I don't work at Zoom, so it's tough for me as a person in the software industry to talk for that company and how secure are they. I think it's a matter of really doing your due diligence as a medical professional, as a practice, to see if that particular product is good for you. And, you know, kind of checking off the check boxes on what fits your profile of product. I don't know if that fully answers the question, but I, you know, I think that's a good approach to take with any software.
Right. And no, absolutely, for sure. And, you know, to add on, we actually had a follow-up question from another attendee asking about Microsoft Teams. All the same type of platform where they're public companies with public product out there that are used for everyday business. We use Microsoft Teams. We use Zoom here, GoToMeeting at different points of our communication with our clients and counterparts. But we did a lot of due diligence choosing Teams for our product and what we decided to go with. And it had a lot to do with security and had a lot to do with what Zoom was going through earlier this year. But in the end, doing your own due diligence to me sounds like the way to go. Robin or Joy, did you have something to add for that?
Yeah, I think the ultimate litmus test, if I'm a practice, do they have HIPAA compliant controls? Because even Google, regular Google doesn't have anything, but there's ways to configure G Suite that does allow you to have HIPAA compliance. The ultimate litmus test for us, will they sign a BAA? Will you have a business associate agreement that binds them to the industry standards that Daniel was talking about? Do they do penetration testing? Are they encrypting data in motion, data at rest? What is their breach protocol? How will they notify you? These are all really important things because you don't want a vendor that is potentially a bad actor to compromise the security and confidence that you have with your patients now that you've worked so hard to achieve. I think we put a lot of trust into EMR vendors. They're very up to speed on these things. I would not make a blanket statement that every third-party vendor is up to speed on these things. So, and like I said, that kind of pass the OIG has given people is intended and will be short-lived, unequivocally. HIPAA remains paramount in our interactions with patients, and of course, the trust you all have with them as practices and businesses.
Great, thank you. All right, this is a good opportunity now to ask this question and also share with our audience that Chirpy Bird is offering a free telehealth reference guide to all Fireside Chat attendees. So you can come on, I'll be sending you a link at the end of this presentation so you could go on and get that. And I think the question here is, how do I get started with telehealth? What are the steps? Can you kind of go over, Robin or Joy, go over what the steps are to get started with this? Oh, you're on mute, Joy.
Yeah, no, I think that my...
You're good.
My thing is slow, so I'm going to let you go, Robin.
First and foremost, vet several different vendors. Don't just go with one. Don't just sign up and work with Doximity because the guy down the street is doing it. Try them out. Get on a call, do a demo. Most of these for telehealth are relatively short and sweet. And check with your vendor first that you may have for EMR. Give them the benefit of the doubt because some of the pros for ease of use and efficiency of that wholly integrated system are just so incredibly valuable that it makes the workflow, the clicks you're gonna do, so much more seamless, and especially documentation for the physician whose time is so incredibly limited. So I would do that. Make sure you know the details of patient consent for your state for sure. One thing we often see overlooked, and it seems so obvious, is that in your schedule, do you have a telehealth visit? And what types of telehealth visits do you need? Is it a follow-up? Is it for a new patient? Is it for annual wellness? Is it for physical therapy? Whatever's going on. How do we denote that even at a front office level? And then the workflow. Practice. Use the people in the practice as guinea pigs, if you will, to go through the process. Have somebody pick up their phone, an Android, an iPhone, all of the different devices. Don't assume everyone has an iPhone because trust me, your patients do not. Make sure you have compatibility and just practice before you roll this out. And the one thing I think you'll find in our reference guide, telehealth billing requirements, the place of service, payer-specific modifiers. No one wants to do a lot of work and not get reimbursed. Make sure you know those details.
Great. Thank you. So let's hop on to another question here so we can get through them and get everybody back to their day. Daniel, what other changes have been necessitated by COVID-19? Did you see during the as the pandemic has easing? What other changes have you seen?
I mean, there's definitely been a change where there's been a lot of changes in the world. I think one is, you know, I was talking to a pop-up clinic. So there's this concept now of like a pop-up clinic to do rapid testing, mass testing for people. I've never heard of that before the pandemic, right? Like literally they're trying to build these immediate clinics to do these mass tests with people coming in. It's definitely a interesting new world with that, right? So like, I think I've driven by maybe one or two of these where they just literally build a clinic and these cars are coming. Another change that I kind of see happening is the IoT and the world of IoT, the Internet of Things is what they call it. It's these connected devices. I'm wearing an Apple Watch. A lot of these accountability tools that are going into the cloud now, like blood pressure cuffs, glucose meters, scales, thermometers, all of this stuff is kind of going to change the way that we do remote monitoring. So RPM, remote, you know, patient monitoring, it's kind of a new thing that's coming out. And was it going to be embraced before COVID? The answer is yes, but the adoption rate would have probably been a lot slower. I think providers are now way more open-minded to getting, say, an FDA, you know, blood pressure cuff. Does this patient have, you know, high blood pressure? If there's, say, a patient, say they're in their, you know, 90s and they're kind of homebound, do you really need them to come in? Or can you have them put that cuff on and can you have that virtual visit and say, hey, your blood pressure is okay, and have that conversation? It's definitely going to change the industry with through the technology, through the remote, you know, monitoring, through telehealth. The world is definitely going to, in a good way, we're taking that technology and saying let's apply it to like our health experience as patients. We're all patients at the end of the day. It's great if you can have a conversation with your provider, and you know, we're all busy. Do you need to go to your provider? Sometimes you're second guessing yourself, and having that conversation, and if there's an FDA approved device, why would you not, you know, use that device, and why would the doctor not accept that device? Before COVID, I think it's going to happen, but would it happen as fast? I think it's going to be a rapid adoption very quickly, which we're going to see over the next several years of just not just convenience, but also like reality of, you know, there's a lot happening in the world.
Right. No, I appreciate that, Daniel. And I hope my primary care provider is not listening right now, but I actually have no reason ever to actually go visit him. If he can just see me on the computer and send me my medications, my life would be so much easier, you know, running around with family and so forth. Once again, I hope he's not listening to this call today. But to follow up with that and throw it over to Robin and Joy, where do you see, now that we've talked about all of these different technology enhancements that we've seen, where do you see telehealth going? Where do you see these enhancements being really utilized in these programs? And what is the government going to do about it? Because they still have to pay the doctors. And I know they don't like paying doctors. So...
Well, I'll start off. There seems to be some hinting that, you know, what the changes that they made for telehealth reimbursement might stick around. It's entirely possible that we'll see that extended, which would be great. And I think that, to your point, I think that a lot of practices are really going to be taking a long, hard look about what is actually necessary. Do we actually need patients to come in? Personally, I have some appointments that are now standard online. They used to be in person, and now it is 100% telehealth, and it works just fine for me. I happened to go to the dentist yesterday. They needed to take some pictures of my teeth. that could not be done online. There's part of me that wishes, I'm like, can I just stick my teeth up to this camera and we can call that a day? But I don't think that would get the job done. But I think that, you know, really reflecting on what can be done in person versus virtually is going to be huge. You know, one thing that shows up for me as a question is considering all of this, the equipment that can be used for remote patient monitoring, is the onus on the patient to actually purchase that and keep it and maintain it? Or is that something that, you know, perhaps gets loaned out to the patient, mailed out, and then asked to return? Or what would the expectation here? I think ultimately for the experience for patients is going to change significantly, even in terms of just using their phone or their iPad or their computer in a new way, where we will start to see disparities of who has access and who doesn't. And so, you know, it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. We've had some conversations where, you know, kind of like a public library where people can go use equipment, you know, will we start to use other community centers where there's equipment that's available for folks that don't have it in-house?
Right. That's great. I know my kids would love blood work and booster shots to be done virtually or not at all. If they could figure out a way to do that, you'd make a couple kids real happy here in New Jersey. Robin, did you have anything to add to that?
No, I think with the expansion of remote patient monitoring, not just the FDA devices, but the new adoption of so many cellular scales, things that are connecting to these things we've been walking around with so long, that COVID has done more in 6 or 7 months for digital health than, as far as advancement, than the last 6 or 7 years, and adoption especially. And so I think those pop-up clinics, the drive-through clinics, I think they're going to continue. I think you're going to see more of them. We already see major health systems getting really good at this, right? So meeting a need and pivoting very quickly. You know, and with the deployment and more pervasive use of remote patient monitoring, I think we have to look at the digital construct and delivery of then chronic care management, principal care management for these patients where it makes sense not to leave the home, and then the policy that governs that. Because right now, if you want to do chronic care management, you had to see the patient within the last year face to face. So now as we get here and the policy isn't meeting the need because we've had 6 or 7 months of COVID and they didn't go to the doctor during the holidays, we're going to run out of time real quick. So I'm excited to see the policy catch up to the need and all of this cool stuff going on in digital delivery of care. And for mostly well patients, I think even the way people view the emergency department is going to shift. Hopefully for the better. But yeah, there's definitely a lot of evolution coming, and no doubt what we've experienced in the last probably 90 to 120 days is probably just the first iteration of many to come.
Great, thank you. So this is the point where I'm going to ask all of our attendees, if you have questions, to get them in now so we can get them to our specialists and experts that are on the line right now. But I have a question for each one of you left. And Robin and Joy, feel free for one of you to take this question. But what is Chirpy Bird currently doing to help their clients with telehealth and implementing it?
So we have a couple of partnerships we are a partner of Dr. Crono to Daniel, who's on the line today. And so we help with workflow. We also have a partnership with standalone partners. We really remain quite agnostic because not every tool is right for everybody. But we are trying to help people refine some of their aspects of their workflow and realize what they can capture from a policy and billing standpoint, now that they have these tools for digital delivery of care. And a lot of what we've talked about more recently is don't accept a claim with $0 back on it or denial. There's so much available to you from different payers for different types of service. We can categorize it somehow. So don't accept zero. And then we're talking about, okay, well, now that I have telehealth, how do I do the e-visit with tracking portal time? What are the mechanisms for things, and how do we help do that? So we're doing a lot of small project work to help small, medium, and large size practices just really optimize.
Great, thank you so much, Rob. And Daniel, sort of the same question over to you. At Dr. Chrono, what are you seeing is the future of where Dr. Chrono is going to help? We know you have a fully wholly product within your EHR, but where do you see that changing, and what do you see moving forward? How are you helping your clients with telehealth? Nope, you're on mute. There you
go. We have a very open philosophy on partnering with any company that kind of what the provider feels fits their needs. So if there's a lab company, we'll work with them and see if there's a way to partner to share that data and have the workflows work really well. If there's a IoT device, Internet of Things device, we'll figure out a way to get that data into the EHR for them. I think we're thinking about telehealth the same way, where we have several offerings on our platform where the provider can look at 9 different telehealth offerings and see if there's something that fits their needs. Again, we, because of COVID, built a telehealth solution. Prior to COVID, we did not have it. So that's another way that we were supporting the providers, where a lot of them just felt like, oh my God, what am I going to do? I can't see my patients. You know, maybe the provider themselves got COVID, right? But they still want to help and support their patients. They could do that all virtually. For us, it's really about, what does the future of a medical practice look like? What is that, right? And in my mind, a lot of it is going to be virtual care. So how do we make those investments in the technology side as a group of people where we can have the practice modernize? And what does that really mean? It's really looking out at the world saying, you know, what's going to make the provider's life easier? What's going to make the patient's life easier? So really just supporting them, I think, is really what we're trying to, that's our goal. It's taking technology and applying it for the patient and the provider. So a few of the things I mentioned, like RPM, remote patient monitoring, I think that there's going to be a big shift towards those types of solutions.
Gotcha, terrific. And you know, the earlier our attendees on this get involved in telehealth, those who haven't yet, the better shape you will be taking a look now at what the different options are out there and getting involved. And that's why we have our experts on the line here today, and you'll receive information on how to get in contact with both these organizations after this call. I want to thank Daniel, Robin, and Joy for a wonderful short fireside chat that we have today without the fire, considering it's 110 here in New Jersey. Thank God. Maybe we'll change it to poolside chat. But there's a quick survey at the end I'd like everybody to fill out if you have the opportunity. Once again, I really appreciate your time today. And please stay tuned for our Healthmonix webinars that are coming up the rest of the month of July and into August. Everybody have a wonderful day. And please reach out if you need anything. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.